Lord, we thank you for your word and your grace and the people in your church that we can work together and come together and minister for you. And as we spend time tonight learning from your word in Hebrews, help us to have a better appreciation of your inspired word and the sundry times and diverse manners in which you spake to us, to Israel, so that we can learn about who you are and what your will is. Amen. Okay, tonight we are starting the verse by verse in the book of Hebrews, starting with the first two verses, one and a half technically. So we're getting a slow start, but it's appropriate because Hebrews 1:1, the first verse in Hebrews, is one of the best first verses in the Bible. It's a pretty interesting study if you want to look at all of the first verses of every book in the Bible. It's interesting how much some of them say, how little others say, but each one's unique. And there are better ones and worse ones. Genesis 1:1, of course, is the most popular and one of the best first verses, and what a good verse for the beginning of your Bible, too, saying so much about truth. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth, and so it tells us time elements there about what God did in the beginning, the structure of the universe with the heaven and the earth. And of course, the whole first chapter gives us an introduction to creation, which is an appropriate beginning to a book about God's will for the ages. But Genesis 1:1 is a great introductory verse. John 1:1 is also pretty theologically heavy. When John 1:1 starts, it says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." And so that verse also has been the center point of many arguments about whether Jesus was God, the Son of God, or not, with Jehovah Witnesses and other cults and things. So such a weighty verse, the book of John, starting out with that, saying the Word was God in the beginning, going back even before Genesis 1:1, before the creation. So you have a verse like that. I put Job 1:1 on your outline as another example of a good verse. Not as heavy theologically as John 1:1 or as universal as Genesis 1:1, but when Job starts his book, you read about a man and tell so much about him just in one sentence. "There was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job. That man was perfect and upright, one that feared God and eschewed evil." In one sentence, you learn so much about that man and what the story is in Job. And it's so appropriate for the book because according to that verse, he's a perfect and upright man. He fears God. He eschews evil. And the rest of the book is about his suffering. And so it really sets the tone for Job, or at least sets a contrast for it in that one single first verse. So Hebrews 1:1, we come to that and we read in Hebrews that God, who at sundry times and in diverse manners spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son. We see so much information in these first two verses here that it is really amazing that the book starts out this way. And I think one reason why this book it was so helpful for people through the centuries for understanding what God was doing and what he will do. So it's appropriate that we just cover the one verse tonight. So much introductory material in here. It starts out with the word God, which in light of last week's lesson is very appropriate. Last week we talked about the authorship of Hebrews and who wrote it, and what the arguments were for Paul writing it, and what the arguments were for Paul not writing it, the other options that people have mentioned throughout history, and whether it matters or not, and why. We covered that last week. And whether or not you take the position Paul did, and we take the position, or at least I do, you've been persuaded in your own mind, that Paul did not, because of the pronouns and because of the context and the doctrinal material in the book, the first word of the book is God. Which, just backing up for a moment about the human author, we know that the true author of every book in the Bible is God. 2 Timothy 3:16 says, "All scripture is given by inspiration of God." And so that's the most important thing to remember about every book in the Bible, is that we're not just reading man's words. We're reading God's words as he gave them and as the Holy Spirit moved men of God to write them. Okay, so that it starts with God is appropriate. As it speaks about God's fulfillment of his promises and his purposes in the ages to come. That's what the book of Hebrews deals with. Okay, so it's interesting, it starts with God. Also interesting on the subject of authorship is that every letter that Paul wrote, Romans through Philemon, begins with his name, Paul, and Hebrews does not. And so very important by its absence is Paul's name in this verse. And so if you're studying the authorship or studying the book, it is significant to note that Paul didn't start this letter with his name if Paul wrote it. He didn't do that. And why? Because every other epistle we know he wrote, he started with his name. And so he didn't. We mentioned last week, some people have the idea throughout history that he did that on purpose in order to be anonymous so that the Hebrews would not reject him. But of course, we've mentioned how that's a strange idea, seeing as how later in the epistle, people use evidences in the epistle to say that Paul wrote it. You know, him mentioning Timothy, him in prison, things like that. So if he was trying to remain anonymous, he didn't do a very good job, seeing as how so many people think he did write it. But God wrote this book, and it starts out talking about the way God spoke or spake in time past, which is a significant issue. As we're talking about the Holy Ghost on Sundays, this is an issue that's going to come up. How does the Holy Ghost speak to you? How does the Holy Ghost speak to us? And Hebrews 1:1 deals with this, how God has spoken, how he spake, okay? And so we know that God has spoken because we have his words. But when you think about there being a God at all, okay, the majority of humans on the planet know that there's a God. Romans 1 says we all know that there's a God. Some of us reject him in their minds. But if there's a God and God has a purpose, that is, God has a will for his creation in human history, this requires God to speak in history, to reveal himself, to intervene. Okay, and we as Christians understand that he has intervened. We have a record of it, and Hebrews 1:1 describes the record of it. God, who at sundry times and diverse manners spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophets. Then it ends with, in these last days, spoken unto us by his Son. Okay, so we have a continuation of how God has spoken right here in Hebrews 1:1-2, right? And so it's a fascinating verse that we're going to dig into a little bit tonight as we talk about the importance of it for dispensational Bible study. But God has spoken. The verse says, unto the fathers by the prophets. Now, when it says unto the fathers, this is, of course, is talking about the fathers of Israel, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and those 12 fathers of the 12 tribes. He spoke in times past unto the fathers by the prophets. When you talk about the fathers of Israel, this is something that would include the majority of the world as we know it today. They call them the Abrahamic faiths, right? Christianity, Judaism, Islam, all trace their origins about their words from God, so-called, to Abraham, and back when he spake to him. Okay, and so when Hebrews 1:1 says that God at sundry times in diverse manners spake in time past unto the fathers, this is something that the majority of the world agrees on, believe it or not, that God spoke to Abraham. Now the Muslims will deny that he spoke to Isaac, instead he spoke to Ishmael, you know, but Abraham they agree on. Okay, so that's something interesting to note as well. It's simply the Eastern religions, and of course humanism and atheism, that denies that God has spoken at all to the nation of Israel. So when we talk about God speaking in history, Israel becomes prominent. Israel is where we see God speaking. Hebrews being written to Hebrews, again, an appropriate beginning here, saying, hey, God has spoken in time past, spoken to you guys, spoken to Israel. And Israel is how we know God has spoken. Without Israel, we would have no record of God's intervention in history without Israel. The book of Genesis, of course, extends past beyond the beginning of Israel, but it was written by Moses, right, who delivered Israel out of Egypt. So without Israel, we would not have the Bible. God inspired his words through the men of Israel, through the Jews, through the Hebrews. And we know that from the scripture in Romans 3, verse 1, when Paul says, what advantage has the Jew? As he, in Romans 1 through 3, condemned all men, Jews and Gentiles, he asked the question then, well, what advantage then is there for being a Jew if it doesn't earn you some righteousness, being a Jew, just being one? And of course, being one does not today earn you any sort of standing with God. Well, Paul says, much every way, Romans 3, verse 2, chiefly because that unto them were committed the oracles of God. The oracles, the sayings, the records, right? The things that he had revealed. Okay? The Jews held the oracles of God. The scriptures have always been Israel's, right? It's only in this dispensation when Israel's fallen that the scriptures, as they were left, are now and have been in the hands of the church for 2,000 years, those believers who need the scriptures to know what God said. Right? Isn't that interesting? So even today, as we Gentiles, or members of the body of Christ, are preaching the word of God, we're using the word of God that was inspired through Jews, through Israel. And so chiefly, they were given the oracles of God. They had that privilege. In Romans chapter 9, in verse 4 and 5, Paul lists a lot more privileges that Israel was given. He says, Israelites are his kinsmen in the flesh, to whom pertains the adoption, the glory, the covenants, the giving of the law, the service of God, and the promises, whose are the fathers, and of whom as concerning the flesh Christ came. Which, by the way, in that verse right there, you can highlight that, because that's a good verse to show people that when Jesus Christ came, he came to Israel. You know, he said that in Matthew chapter 15. He said that in Matthew chapter 10. He also says in Romans 9 verse 5, Christ came to Israel in the flesh. And it says, who is over all, God bless forever. Amen. So the word of God came to Israel, was given to them. It was supposed to be fulfilled through them. And quite literally, the capital W, word of God, came to Israel, Jesus Christ. Okay, so Hebrews 1:1 starts that God spake unto the fathers by the prophets. And he's talking about Israel there. And if you go back and read the prophets, Malachi, Obadiah, any of these prophets, the first verses of a lot of these prophets say, the word of the Lord as it came to Jonah, Malachi, the burden of the word of the Lord as it came to Malachi. You know, so all of these books in Israel's scripture claim to be God's words. They say, thus saith the Lord, over and over again. Some people ask you, well, how do you know the Bible is God's words and not just a book written by men? Well, men did write the book. Everybody knows that. The question is whether God inspired them to write it or not, whether it's inspired by God, God's words. And one way we know that it is because it claims to be. And that's not the only reason. And just because someone stands up and says, I'm God, doesn't mean that they are. But the fact is that very few books, quite frankly, have claimed that. And that's because they would not. You understand? So if you were to write a book, the only way you would claim that your book was God-given is if somehow you were under some sort of delusion. Okay? You say, or God could have spoken to him. That's true. God could have. But very few people have claimed that. That's the point. And those that have in history have been proven false and liars. And so it's interesting that this book, amongst the holy books of the religions of the world, alone claims such bold things, such as the word says this, the word of the Lord came to these people, the word of the Lord said this, and prophesies things that came true and that have been preserved for millennia. Okay? So when, again, Hebrews 1:1 says that God spake unto the fathers by the prophets, it's making the same claim as the Old Testament. The Lord has spoken. Okay? God has spoken. He has spoken to Israel. He's spoken in the Bible. He's spoken to us. The us here, of course, being Hebrews, in Hebrews 1, verse 2. Okay? So with that understanding, with that appreciation of what the author is saying here, let's go back and deal with this phrase, who at sundry times in diverse manners spake. So we know God spake, and we know that he spake unto the fathers by the prophets, which is to Israel. So they have a significant place in God's revelation, in God revealing scripture and his words to humanity. But it says he spake at sundry times and in diverse manners. That's interesting. So apparently it's not something where Israel could all the time enter into a conversation with God. This was not the case, apparently. It was not the case where God had a weekly update with Israel. All right, Israel, here's the new word. Here's the fresh word this week. They couldn't make God speak. And God didn't have regular meetings with them. Okay, it says sundry times, diverse manners he spake, but he spake unto the fathers by the prophets unto Israel. That's interesting. Okay, that word sundry, you may be more familiar with the word asunder in your Bible, right? He tore asunder. And that's where the word sundry comes from. It has to do with separation or different or several. We use the word several. He spoke at several times. And so several times, I mean, it's not the same time. They're different times, you see. And so he spake at sundry times. It could also mean diverse times, sundry times. And what it's saying here then is that as God spoke, he spoke over different times. Now, that is also an interesting idea. In fact, it's the dispensational idea, okay? Because many people... Well, let's just say it this way. It's wrong to think that the Bible just fell out of the sky at just one time, boom, there's the Bible, and people have it, and they just try to follow it just like some other holy book. You know, the Quran claims that, by the way. The Quran was written down at one time, at least, you know, in a matter of a single time, days, months, or whatever, by the angel speaking to Muhammad, and Muhammad spoke it to someone else because he couldn't write it down, so someone else had to write it down for him. And it was all just spat out, just at one time, okay? The Bible's not like that. The Bible is written by 40 different authors over the span of 1,500 years. That's a lot of time, okay? And so these sundry times in which God spake wasn't just all at once. And that actually, again, points to its authenticity, its seriousness of being God's word, okay? Because it'd be much harder to authenticate a claim that God gave you his word if it's just a single time he spoke, right? You say, God spoke to you? When? Well, last week. And he spoke to no one else? Nope, only me. Wow, that's interesting. That's hard to prove. You see, that's hard to grasp. Okay, and yet when you have God speaking at sundry times over a long period of different times, okay, now suddenly you have more and more proof, more and more evidence, more and more revelation from God to know who he is and who he's speaking about, especially when you compare the revelations and compare him speaking. Okay, there are people who study, linguists study language and the way people write, and you can study the way people write, and you can tell sometimes without their name being on the writing who wrote it or where it came from based on what they wrote and the style in which they write. And this is a study of literature that people do, okay? And if you were to study the Bible and you study the books as we do, all being one singular Bible, a collection of 66 books, we can see that these books, unique among every book in human history, there are 66 books that we have gathered together that you can compare with one another and contrast. We can take Hebrews and compare it to Isaiah and compare it to Psalms and compare it to Genesis. And we can make these comparisons and it fits. What they're saying matches, you see. It's not as if these 40 different authors had different viewpoints, had different directions which they were going. Okay, they were all speaking the same things as far as a single purpose, God's will for the ages, right? Okay, and so we see that in the scripture. And that also is significant. We understand that the Bible is unique among books in the world. No other book can you study like you study the Bible. Okay? You can't study 66 books by 40 different authors and compare them and contrast them and relate them and learn from them in combination like you can with the Bible. Okay, you can learn new things by comparing the books together, right? Very hard, okay? So the Bible is unique in this regard, all right? So at separate times, at sundry times, God has spoken. Now, we as dispensationalists often get a bad rap because we talk about dividing the Bible. So this verse is an important one for you to know as a dispensationalist. In fact, it's a very good place for you to start if you're trying to explain to someone the idea of dispensational Bible study. You say, why would I start here? It's not even Paul's book, right? Well, you don't start here just because it's Paul's book or not. You start here because it's explaining how God has spoken throughout history. And that's what you're trying to communicate when you talk about dispensational Bible study, right? Of course, we emphasize what God's doing now, what God has spoken for us today in the revelation of the mystery, and that's what we're going to end up in as far as the instructions for our participation. But what we're trying to say is that God hasn't said, spoke at the same time to the same people in the same way about the same thing. Okay? That God has spoken at sundry times in diverse manners and about different things, you see. He's instructed us with different instructions. So we can start in Hebrews 1:1 and show someone the idea of progressive revelation, right? In the Bible, if all we had was Genesis through Deuteronomy, the Torah, the first five books of the Bible, we wouldn't know things that were later known in Psalms and the prophets or in Paul's epistle. We wouldn't know that. Okay. In the same way, if all we had was the Old Testament, we wouldn't know things that were revealed later by the apostles in the New Testament. Okay. Getting more specific, if all we had was Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, we wouldn't know what was revealed to Paul in the revelation of the mystery. You see, because they were revealed at sundry times. Now, this is a very simple concept, but it's something the Bible says right here in Hebrews 1, verse 1. And so you can call dispensationalism a heresy. You can call it some sort of a theology, man-made theology, but Hebrews 1:1 has to be dealt with, that God spoke at several sundry times in diverse manners and wasn't always to the same people and about the same thing. Okay? And so we have to understand that. Not every time God spake Not every manner was the same. Not every purpose and instruction he gave was the same. Not every revelation of God is the same. To think that everything in the Bible says exactly the same thing. And earlier I said they all have agreement. And by that I meant they all speak about the common topic and the common purpose, right? But they do speak specifically about different things. So to say that you can read any passage in the Bible and apply it to your life is simply wrong. Okay, it's simplistic. Okay, it's something that just will not work. It means you have not studied it well enough. Okay, and most people realize that. Most people will make a division or make a sundry separation, right, between at least the Old Testament and New Testament. Okay, but we talked about this last Sunday. The Old Testament New Testament division is too simple of a division. There's more going on than that. Okay, there's more going on than just Old Testament New Testament. And so if we just look at a few comparisons here, which I have on your outline, we can see a way to show people what these sundry times and diverse manners may include. Okay, look at Romans chapter 10. If you open up the book of Romans and then in your other hand get Deuteronomy, as we can make a couple of comparisons from these. It's always nice to compare Romans with something because the theology in Romans most everybody will agree with. Now, they'll have their different interpretation on it, but they like Paul's epistles. They like the New Testament as far as they think it applies to them. But when you show them that it's different than what God has said before, it brings up this question of, you know, well, if God says things that are that different, then how do we know what God is saying for us? So Deuteronomy 6:25 and Romans chapter 10. Romans 10, verse 4. It says, Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believes. For Moses describes the righteousness which is of the law, that the man which does these things shall live by them. That's Leviticus 18:5. But the righteousness which is of faith speaks on this wise. And so you see a contrast here. You have Moses' description of righteousness, which is of the law. The man which doeth these things shall live by them. The do there is the emphasis. In verse 4, it says, Christ is the end of the law for righteousness. So it's a different thing. And he spoke it at sundry times. Now, if God said both of those things at the same time, God would be contradictory. The Bible would be contradictory. This is the false idea that the skeptics have about the Bible. Well, I'm reading the Bible and there's contradictory things. Yes, but it just plop out of the sky at one time, you see. It was revealed at sundry times in diverse manners. It's a progressive revelation. And so in Deuteronomy 6:25, when it says, it shall be our righteousness if we observe to do all these commandments before the Lord our God. It'll be our righteousness. And Leviticus 18:5 says, if we do these things, we'll live in them. Romans 10:4 says, Christ is the end of the law for righteousness. There's no more claim you can do today that if you keep the law, you'll be righteous. Right? That's not an acceptable option. It's not on the table anymore, you see. God has changed that operation because he's revealed more information. Okay, he's changed how he's operating and the manner in which he's operating with people in the world, okay? You're still in Deuteronomy. Take Deuteronomy and 1 Timothy chapter 1. Deuteronomy and 1 Timothy. These are just a few examples, and we've all covered many more examples like these in the past, but I think it's significant to cover a few of these in Hebrews 1 verse 1 because it's important to realize that the sundry times and diverse manners teach dispensational Bible study. That's what that is. Okay? Call it whatever you want. There are different things going on. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 6 and 7 says, there are some having swerved, having turned aside from the truth, that is, they have swerved away from the truth, having turned aside unto vain jangling, desiring to be teachers of the law, understanding neither what they say nor whereof they affirm. Now, there are denominations, major denominations today, who will tell you the law is still in effect. In fact, we were talking about Seventh-day Adventists on Sunday. Jeremy was given something by a Seventh-day Adventist evangelist, right? And I looked it up, and I did not know this, but they had, I think recently, taken the fifth position as the fifth largest Christian group, if you call them Christian, you know, including the Catholics and the Eastern Orthodox and the Assemblies of God, and then you got the Seventh-day Adventists. You're like, wow, the fifth largest. Yeah, they're pretty big, apparently, especially internationally. And they teach that the law of God is still applicable, still in effect, and that you're required to do it today. Now, they've tried to be more amenable to evangelical theology the last, you know, few decades, and have tried to emphasize that we also believe you're saved by grace through faith, not of works. But then the next statement is, well, the law is still applicable, and you have to keep it. You're required to keep it. And thus, the Sabbath law, Seventh-day Adventist, the Seventh-day Sabbath law-keeping requirement. But 1 Timothy 1, 6 and 7 says, there are some who desire to be teachers of the law. They don't understand what they're saying, nor whereof they affirm. They don't understand that Christ is the end of the law for righteousness, and that God is now dispensing his grace to operate on the world through his grace. Okay. Paul calls the teachers of the law vain janglers. You know, janglers is an odd word to use, but it's vanity what they're speaking. Okay. Now, in Deuteronomy 32 and verse 47, you go back to the law, which talks about the Sabbath days and talks about those commandments, which the Reconstructionists and a lot of the Reformers will claim needs to be the standard by which we institute our laws in our country, is the law. So we need to reinstitute the law of God in our country as it's still applicable today. Deuteronomy 32, verse 47 says, it is not a vain thing for you, because it is your life, and through this thing ye shall prolong your days in the land. So Deuteronomy 32, verse 47 says, the law is not a vain thing for you, it is your life. 1 Timothy 1, verse 6 says, it's a vain thing if you try to teach the law. Right? Is Paul a heretic? What's happening here? Is the Bible contradictory? Or is it that God spake at sundry times in diverse manners about the changing of his operation and what he's doing in the world? At one time, in Deuteronomy 32, he gave a law to Israel in which that was their life. It was given to them to do, okay, and to live therein. Later, Christ came. Later, he revealed something to Paul, and now the law is not our way of operating, our way of living. Okay, we do not live according to the law. And saying that makes lawkeepers cringe, but we live according to Christ, which is far better and far more excellent. Okay, and so there's a different way in which God is operating. Galatians chapter 3, we can go there and we see a few different changes in the structure. In fact, go back to Romans. Let's go back to Romans there. And we can draw a simple chart of the sundry times which we're talking about by going to Romans and Galatians. In Romans chapter 5, Romans 5 verse 14. Romans 5 verse 12 talks about by one man sin entered and death by sin, that one man being Adam. And so you've seen the charts before. You have Adam, the one man in the beginning of the world, by whom sin entered, and death by sin. Now Romans 5:14 says, nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses. And so the Bible here makes a time period, it makes a distinction in time, in history, from Adam to Moses. Now you can study about why he's making that period there, and you talk about that's where death reigned, and that's where sin was, and that sort of thing, but what was important about Moses? Well, the law was given to Moses, right? And so before Moses, there was no law given from God. There were instructions, there were commandments, things like this. There were sacrifices Cain and Abel offered. But Moses, the law was given to him, and it was Moses that baptized that nation on dry ground as he delivered them out of Egypt, right? Led of God, of course. And so from Adam to Moses, we have this time in which God spake, right? By the way, this is where he spake unto the fathers, because in this time you have Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. You have the promises that he revealed in Genesis 12. And so God spake at this time, right? And then there's a sundry time, a different time in which God spake to Moses. And from Moses all the way through, we have the law, right? Look at Luke chapter 16. In Luke chapter 16, in verse 16, Luke 16, 16. Moses was given the law, and every prophet that was given to Israel, one of their key ideas was that you're breaking the law, repent, and keep the law. Change your mind about your sin and your direction, get on course, and start doing what God told you to do, do the law. Luke 16, 16 says, the law and the prophets were until John. Okay, so here we have John the Baptist, okay, which is interesting for those Baptist out there, because they like to make the beginning of the church with John. And so you have John the Baptist here, where Luke 16 says the law and the prophets were until him, and since that time the kingdom of God is preached. So we can make some delineations here. We have promise back here, promise to the fathers, okay, We have the law from Moses until John. We've got kingdom. Since John, the kingdom was preached. John was significant and the greatest of the prophets in that he was the one that would precede the Messiah, right? Jesus called him the greatest of the prophets because he was preaching, the one after me is the Messiah. No more prophet after prophet after prophet after prophet without the Messiah. Now the Messiah is going to come. Now the kingdom is going to come. The gospel of the kingdom they preached was that the kingdom of God is at hand. The time is fulfilled. So here we had a time of waiting for the kingdom, right? Well, here, a sundry time, okay, we've got the gospel of the kingdom being preached. Luke 16, verse 16, all right? And so you have that. Now, go back to Galatians chapter 3. The kingdom of God was being preached, but as a fact of history, the kingdom of God never came. The kingdom of God that was promised never came. In Galatians chapter 3, we have a description in verse 11 and 12 of the law and how Christ made a change here. In Galatians 3:11, no man is justified by the law in the sight of God. It is evident, for the just shall live by faith. The law is not of faith, but the man that doeth them shall live in them. That's a quote of Leviticus 18:5. That was what was given to Moses. That was the law operation. The man that does them will live in them. Okay. Christ hath redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is every man cursed is everyone that hangs on a tree. Okay. I missed verse 10, which is significant. Back up in verse 10, it says, for as many as are of the works of the law are under a curse. For it is written, cursed is everyone that continues not in the things that are written in the book of the law. So by the time Paul writes Galatians 3, he's saying the law was a curse. Christ came to become a curse for us. So you have something else here. You put Christ on the board. Okay, Christ, you have his cross. The kingdom was being preached, which was a time of the kingdom. The time was being fulfilled. But when Paul preaches Galatians 3, he says the law is a curse, and Christ came to become a curse for us. He talks about this thing called faith. In Ephesians 3, 1 and 2, we've read many times before, Paul says the dispensation of the grace of God is given to me. What about faith and grace? Okay. And of course, Paul in Romans 16, 25 says that he was given a gospel, the preaching of Jesus Christ according to revelation of the mystery. So we start seeing these sundry times where Paul says, in time past, there was Israel. In time past, there was the circumcision. But now, okay, there's neither Jew nor Gentile. Well, there's no Jew or Gentile, there can't be the kingdom because the kingdom was given to Israel to reign and rule over Gentiles. And so you have these sundry times happening. Here's Paul. And the dispensation of grace was given to him. And so we see a time when there was no law, but it was still part of prophecy. We see a time when there was law, that was part of prophecy. We see a time of the kingdom, the time is being fulfilled, and their operation started to change there in the Sermon on the Mount. We have a time when Christ came and faith was an issue. And so we'll see this in Hebrews. This is where Hebrews is at, of course. Okay, Hebrews starts out talking about the sundry times because Hebrews says the times are changing. Hebrews is writing about, there were things going on, they are no more, right? They're going away. The times are changing. So he starts out by saying, God spake a sundry times. God spake in diverse manners. Why isn't it an odd thing that God speaks now about this? You say. So that's what Hebrews 1:1 starts out with, is changing in which God has spoken a sundry times. And again, this is why some people confuse Hebrews with Paul, because they see Paul also has a change with the dispensation of grace. And so they say, well, it must be a Pauline book. Well, the nature of the change described in Hebrews is different than the nature of the change that Paul describes in his other epistles. Okay, the change in Hebrews is from the old covenant to the new covenant. The change in Israel is the law on stone to the law in their hearts. Was those Israelites who were born Jews and those who were born Jews and also followed the Messiah, thus born again Jews, okay, born of the Spirit. Paul talks about a new creature that was neither Israel nor Gentiles that does not live under the law, okay? They have no covenants, right? So all of this is basic dispensational teaching, and this is, again, comes from Hebrews chapter 1. And this isn't unique to mid-acts dispensationalism. I didn't emphasize so much the difference between Paul and Peter on this simple chart. This is basic dispensational understanding. Okay, any dispensationalists, from Charles Ryrie, who died just last week, I think a week and a half ago, Charles Ryrie died at age 90, one of the leaders of the dispensationalism, Acts 2 dispensationalism, over the last century. And in his popular book, which we've quoted before, he talks about dispensationalism being this God speaking at sundry times, God dealing with the people in the Bible at different manners, you know, in different manners. He gave to Israel something different than he gave to the church. Hebrews 1:1 talks about this, okay? So, look at 1 Peter chapter 1:9. I said the nature of the change between the nature of the change in Hebrews is different than the nature of the change given to Paul. And this is something we need to appreciate, okay? Paul wasn't the first one to introduce change in the Bible. We talk about it as mid-existentialists, the greatest change, the greatest division in your Bibles between prophecy and mystery. So we kind of lump all of prophecy together, and then we put mystery in contrast, which is appropriate, because that is the greatest separation you can make in your scripture. If you're going to have a twofold sundry time, and that's all you're going to make is a twofold division, prophecy and mystery is the one to do, not Old Testament, New Testament, right? But understand, in prophecy, there were changes. Prophecy being everything that was spoken since the world began, in Adam and Moses and through John and the kingdom, and in Hebrews and the kingdom to come now, the ages to come. There were changes, you see. When Paul writes Romans 11, as Paul is preaching the mystery of Christ, preaching the dispensation of the grace of God, Paul says in Romans 11 that the salvation will come to Israel. And so the kingdom that started to be preached here and here is no longer being preached to Israel, but it will be preached. He talks about the ages to come, right, and how they'll be saved in the future. And that's God's covenant unto them, right? So there are changes that Paul introduces, but it's not the only changes in the scripture. 1 Peter, look at 1 Peter 1, verse 9. Peter talks about changes within prophecy. Like, this is not a mystery here, as some have wrongly interpreted it. 1 Peter 1, 9, he says, receive the end of your faith, even the salvation of your souls. And he's talking here about receiving salvation when Christ returns in the future. This is not receiving salvation now, receiving salvation in the future. He says, receiving the end of your faith, even the salvation of your souls, of which salvation the prophets have inquired and searched diligently, who prophesied of the grace that should come unto you. And so there were in prophets prophecies of grace. You can go back there and read Hosea. Hosea prophesies grace. Okay? Back there in Genesis, and Isaiah prophesies grace. And so Peter says that the prophets prophesied grace that should come unto them. Of course, the new covenant was gracious. The old covenant required Israel to do the law or die. Well, they failed. And so the fact that God will give them a new covenant that would pay for the sins of the old one, thank you, God, if you're Israel, that's a gracious opportunity. Okay? And so they prophesied of the grace that should come unto you, the you there being the stranger scattered Israel, the remnant of Israel. But look at verse 11. It says, they searched what or what manner of time the Spirit of Christ, which was in them, did signify, when it testified beforehand the sufferings of Christ and the glory that should follow, unto whom it was revealed that not unto themselves, but unto us, they did minister those things. And so Peter says that when the prophets spoke of the things of Christ, they didn't know what they were talking about. So when they happened, when Christ died, he suffered, and then he rose from the dead, and the kingdom come, and all that, they didn't understand the timing of those things. It says, searching what or what manner of time. You see, they didn't understand the timing. So when Hebrews 1:1 says God spake at sundry times, and Hebrews starts to talk about the changing times, Hebrews speaks from a position like Peter, where he can look back and say, look, guys, look, Jews, look, Hebrews, things have changed, and things are changing. Okay, prophecies are being fulfilled. For so long in Israel's history, from this ministry here of Jesus back to Moses, it had been the same thing, law, law, law. Okay. When John came, who they cut his head off, he was introducing a change. When Christ came, whom they crucified on the cross, he was introducing a change. Okay. When the Holy Ghost came down, they were offering the kingdom, introducing a change. And Peter and Hebrews talks about this change for Israel, this change of better things, a better covenant. The kingdom coming. In 1 Peter 2:7 says, unto you therefore which believe, he is precious. Unto them which be disobedient, the stone which the builders allowed, the same is made the head of the corner. Peter says there are two groups in Israel at his time when he wrote 1 Peter. There's the believing group and the unbelieving group. You that believe, Christ is precious. You that do not believe, Christ is a stumbling block. You see? And so you see the significance, hopefully, with Hebrews 1, 2, when it says, God at sundry times spake, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son. Those last three words, that's the bomb right there in Hebrews 1, verse 2, because all Hebrews would agree, yes, God has spoken at sundry times in diverse manners to the fathers, through the prophets. But when it says, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, you got to prove that. And that's what Hebrews does in chapter 1 and chapter 2, and talks about the better things in Christ for Israel. Okay. 1 Peter 2, verse 8 says, the stone of stumbling and the rock of offense, even to them which stumble at the word, being disobedient. Verse 9, but ye, the believers in Israel, are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people. Now, this is an important verse for you to realize is in your Bible, because it's this verse that people will take and connect you to prophecy from this verse right here. Okay. And this is why it's dangerous to take the Hebrew epistles and say they belong to the church, have application to the church, because this verse, so many people, so many theologians have said this verse is why you can be under Israel's covenants. This is why you can be associated with Israel. You can be called spiritual Israel. You can receive things that were promised to Israel, because 1 Peter 2:9, if Peter is writing to the church, to you, to the body of Christ, then he's calling you a holy nation, a royal priesthood, the same things God called Israel. You see. But if you understand that Peter's not talking to the church, and he's talking about Israel, then it makes sense then that he says the believers in Israel, they're the true holy nation. They're the true royal priesthood. And that nation of Israel that does not believe, they're not going to receive the promises. Okay? But look in verse 10. It says, this holy nation, this royal priesthood of people, whom he hath called out of darkness into his marvelous light, which in time past were not a people, but are now the people of God, which had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy. See that but now in 1 Peter 2:10? Mid-expensationalists love to talk about time past, but now, ages to come. And the way they talk about it is on a big scale. There's time past where God spoke to Israel, but now he's speaking to the church. Ages to come, he speaks to Israel again. He deals with them on the earth. And that's a right explanation generally of the thing. But you see here the phrase where Peter uses the but now. And he's talking about but now meaning but now with Israel. But now meaning there's the way he dealt with people under the law, but now Peter says through Christ there's mercy. So there was a change in Israel's prophetic program. Okay? Jesus did not come to kill and destroy. Jesus came to save those that are lost, right? Didn't he give mercy to the adulterous woman in John 8? Right? So there's mercy, there's grace and truth that comes from Jesus. There's a change, and Peter says it only comes through Christ, not through the law. Peter says, but now there's mercy being given to those who weren't given mercy. Okay? Under the law, they were condemned. But now they could receive mercy if they believe Christ is the Son of God. Jesus is the Christ, right? Then they'll get mercy in that new covenant, and they'll enter the kingdom. All right. Peter's talking about that change. Look at Hebrews chapter 8, verse 6. Hebrews deals exactly with what Peter's talking about in Hebrews chapter 8, verse 6. You see the phrase again here, but now. Hebrews 8 is talking about the high priest and talking about the priest on the earth versus the priest that goes to heaven, the priest in the heavenly tabernacle, which is Christ, of course. And it says, Hebrews 8, verse 6, but now hath he obtained a more excellent ministry, by how much also he is the mediator of a better covenant, which is established upon better promises. For if that first covenant had been faultless, then should no place have been sought for the second. For finding fault with them, he saith, behold, the days come, I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. You see what Hebrews is talking about? Hebrews says, there was the old covenant, right? And that old covenant is insufficient to give to Israel what they needed. But now, Christ hath obtained a more excellent ministry for us, Hebrews, right? Through he's the mediator of a better covenant for Israel. He says in Hebrews 8, verse 8, a new covenant with the house of Israel, the house of Judah. So you see. And why is that? Because verse 7 says the first covenant, the old covenant, it wasn't working. There was faults in it. The fault wasn't of God, of course. The fault was man. Man could not do it to live. He couldn't do it. So there was faults in that. So Hebrews explains how this is being replaced. The Old Testament law of Moses will be replaced by the new covenant in Israel. Okay, how Christ is the better priest. There's better promises. There's a better sacrifice. And so there's a change in Israel's program from old to new. So as we separate prophecy and mystery, just on a grand scale, we say, well, there's mystery given to Paul, and then there's prophecy spoken since the world began, Acts chapter 3, verse 21. And Paul says what he speaks was not known since the world began. So there's a difference right here. Inside of prophecy, there's change. Inside of prophecy, there's promise, there's Old Testament, there's New Covenant. You see, there's change there, and that's what Hebrews is dealing with. So we have to respect that, and that's how Hebrews begins, is to setting that stage. All right. Let's move on then in Hebrews 1, verse 1. We see the sundry times is significant then in teaching dispensational Bible study. Whether it be changes in Israel's program or changes just overall, understanding this verse and knowing it is important and a good springboard. Hebrews 1, verse 2 says, He hath in these last days spoken unto us by His Son. The last days is also important. We'll deal with this more in the future. But that it says last days, that should tell you something about whether you fit in the audience of Hebrews. Okay? You are not living in the last days. Now, I know many people think that they are. Right, and they read the newspapers. They see the options for the president this year, and they go, "These are the last days." You know, well, there's no Bible verse for that. Okay, that's not what God is doing. Yes, we live in a present evil world, but the last days phrase there is prophetic. You find it in Acts chapter 2 when Peter says the last days were 2,000 years ago. Okay, you find it dealing with Israel's fulfillment when the last days of the world system is replaced by Christ's kingdom on the earth, you see. So that's what last days means. So in Hebrews writes, hath in these last days, it's talking about the fulfillment of prophecy, you see. Not today. So again, important for us to rightly divide prophecy from mystery here. You know, you don't fit in this context. Last day material doesn't apply to you. Also, notice what this phrase says for us when we try to define what the last days mean. Okay, you say, doesn't Paul mention last days? Yeah, but not last days of prophecy, right? And say, so how do you know this isn't talking about that? Because it says in these last days, God spoke through His Son. When's the last time God spoke through His Son? Not for 2,000 years, you see? When God spoke through His Son, it was when His Son came in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, right? At the latest, it's when Christ talked to Paul, but that He didn't speak to you through His Son. And you're not a Hebrew. Last time He spoke to the Hebrews through His Son was in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. So Hebrews 1, 2 is in the context of trying to get people to understand that the person who came in the flesh in His earthly ministry, that Jesus of Nazareth, is the Son of God. He hath in these last days spoken to us by His Son. Okay? And so it's connected to Hebrews, to Israel, not to us. Now, I spent a few minutes here dealing with the diverse manners. As it says, He spoke in sundry times and in diverse manners. He spake in time past. The manners in which God speaks is significant because people ask, how is God speaking today? How does God speak to me? And you can do a study on this in the scripture, and you see there's many ways God speaks. There's diverse manners in which God speaks. And it's very wrong, very ignorant to say God works in and God speaks in mysterious ways. That's simply not true. He speaks in diverse manners, true, but you can know what they are. You can't say God speaks in mysterious ways. That's why I'm going to throw up my marbles, you know, or throw down my snake bones and I'll know what God is saying. No, they're not mysterious, mystical, magical ways. They're known ways. Diverse, yes, but known also, yes. Okay. So I listed a few of them here, all of them that I can find in the scripture, about how God speaks, the diverse manners in which He speaks. Okay. Number one is through an audible voice. An audible voice. We find in the Bible where God actually speaks words to people. Of course, in Genesis 1:3, the first time God speaks, He doesn't speak to anybody but Himself. He says, in the beginning was God, and God said, let there be light. So God spoke, okay? And so that He spoke into existence the universe, and you've read the full email forwards, that universe, single verse, God created the universe, God created everything. So He spoke into existence those things. In Genesis 12, 1 through 4, when he came to Abraham, it says God spoke to Abraham. So God told Abraham to leave where he lived and to go into this promised land, this land that He would give to him. And it says Abraham did as God spake to him, as God spoke to him. Okay. So God spoke directly to Abraham. Matthew 3:17, when Jesus was baptized by John, there was a voice from heaven that said, this is My Son in whom I am well pleased. God speaks an audible voice from heaven at that time. Okay. Matthew 17, verse 5, the same thing happened when Peter, James, and John walked up the mount with Jesus, and Jesus was transfigured into his heavenly glory. And they also heard, again, a voice from heaven. My son. Okay. Identification. How do you know Jesus is the Son of God? Well, a few times, God spoke directly with an audible voice to people who heard. Right? You say, well, that's not good enough. Well, you know what? It shouldn't be for you. It shouldn't be good enough for you because you know what? You weren't there. And when someone comes to you and says, God spoke to me in an audible voice, I don't know what to say. I didn't hear it. You heard it. You do what you think is right if you think God's speaking to you. But you know what? He didn't speak to me with an audible voice. And so you better show me how in the history of God's speaking, what you said makes sense. Right? And so this is significant when people say and claim that God spoke to me with an audible voice. God speaking in an audible voice is not your inner voice. You can talk to yourself inside your brain. That is not God. That is not the Holy Spirit. Right? When God speaks an audible voice, it sounds like someone else outside of you. You know the story of Samuel, right? When Samuel became a prophet, he was sleeping, and he heard someone say, Samuel. He gets up, goes to the other room, and says, did you say something? He didn't. It wasn't himself. He knew it wasn't himself, because God is not you, you see. So it's not your inner voice. Don't get that ever confused with God speaking in an audible voice, but God has spoken in an audible voice. Ezekiel 1:28. Most people think that when God speaks, it's like this in Ezekiel chapter 1. And by the way, people often ask, you know, well, doesn't God speak to all of us in an audible voice? Wouldn't that be a lot better? Better for who? You know, God is trying to build a people, to gather a people who please him by faith. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. What kind of faith is there if God is speaking to you and showing himself to you in visions? You see the issue there? How can God communicate faith to people? The only thing that's reliable is faith. This is God's wisdom. And how can that happen if he's constantly speaking to you with an audible voice? In this way, the prophets, Abraham, were spoken to by God. Okay. It's like doubting Thomas, right? He said he wouldn't believe unless he sees the wounds and touches him. And what did Jesus say? He said, blessed are those who believe and don't see. Right. Why? Because they're believing and they aren't seeing. That's faith. But Ezekiel chapter 1, you have here interesting first verse of Ezekiel. It came to pass in the 30th year, in the fourth month, in the fifth day of the month, as I was among the captives by the river of Chebar. So he was taken captive by Israel's enemies. He's sitting next to a river, and the heavens were open. I saw visions of God. Wow. That's an afternoon right there. Okay, so heavens were open, he saw visions of God. That's one way God speaks, visions. But Ezekiel 1:28, as the appearance of the bow, the rainbow, that is in the cloud in the day of rain, so was the appearance of the brightness round about this throne. Ezekiel sees a vision of the throne of God and sees God on it, at least a vision of him. This was the appearance of the likeness of the glory of the Lord. And when I saw it, I fell upon my face, and I heard a voice of one that spake. He said unto me, Son of man, stand upon thy feet. I will speak unto thee. God spoke to him, right? He records it. All the prophets record it, and they say, God said this. God told me to tell you this. And many things the prophet said, God told them directly. Some people have the question of, well, how is the Bible inspired? It was written by men, right? How is it inspired? Well, there's something called plenary verbal inspiration. This is the theological term for saying that God actually told them what to write. It's not as if they woke up one morning and say, hey, the flowers look nice, I'm inspired, and they wrote something in the Bible. That's how a lot of people think it happened. And no, Ezekiel 1:28 and 2:1, God says, stand up, grab a pen, and starts talking to him. Okay? Does that many times in the scripture. And there's other ways, of course, that it's inspired that God speaks, but the audible voice is one way. Dreams is another way that God speaks. In Numbers chapter 12, verse 6, God says, when I send you prophets, I will send them visions and dreams. Okay. One significant dream in your Bible is when Jacob laid down on the rock of Bethel, and the purpose that God revealed to Jacob, the promise that he confirmed to Jacob, was in a dream. Remember the ladder, Jacob's ladder, and the angels, and how that place would be God's house. That's why he called it Bethel. That was in a dream, right? But it wasn't just an ordinary dream. It was a dream in which he knew God was speaking to him. Okay. And again, you say, well, can't anyone claim that? Well, they can. They can claim that, right? The difference is that these are inspired scripture and they align with God's will, which is a good way to test when people tell you God spoke to me, is whether or not it aligns with what God is doing, okay? The dream Jacob was given not only aligns with what happened afterward in Jacob's life and other revelations Jacob was given, but also the things previously given in Jacob's life to Abraham and to Isaac, right? And so those things were confirmed by those other events. There are dreams in the scripture. Prophets is a way that he speaks throughout the Bible, especially as using them to record the scripture. Hebrews 1:1, of course, says that. He's spoken to by the prophets. Angels is another way. Matthew 1:20, Joseph was given instructions by an angel when Matthew 1:20 tells him that that thing conceived in Mary is of the Holy Ghost, is of God, and told him to go down to Egypt and this sort of thing. The angel is communicating to Joseph in a dream. So you have compound manners there, diverse manners. Daniel 9:21, Daniel writes a lot of his book based on what angels were telling him, okay, about what would happen in the future. Of course, a lot of those things have already come true. Daniel was given prophecies about the various empires that have already happened in past history. Acts 7:53, Stephen says that they received the law by the disposition of angels. Angels were God's messengers, that's what the word means, communicating to Israel, okay, what God wanted them to do. Of course, it's very different, our relationship to angels. Angels were not given the mystery of Christ, so angels today are not to be trusted. Galatians 1, Paul says, even if you hear an angel telling you something different, let him be accursed, just forget it. Okay, Paul says, what I'm telling you is from the Lord, okay, and what angels tell you is wrong, right, in this dispensation. That's because angels were given the information and the purpose to help and protect Israel, but it was hid from them what God would do through his church. Ephesians 3, verse 9, it was hidden God. It wasn't given to angels. It was given to you. And so we then assume the title of evangelist, angel being in there. We're now the messengers of God's ministry in heaven and earth, we being the heavenly people. All right. And so that's our specific purpose today. Visions and revelations, of course, are throughout the scripture. You've seen Ezekiel 1:1, we've already read. Isaiah 6, when Isaiah is in the throne room of God as a vision. Revelation 1:1, the whole book is called the Revelation of Jesus Christ. And in 2 Corinthians 12, of course, Paul says, I will come to visions and revelations. Okay, revelations is God revealing through the Spirit something to someone. Ephesians 3:4 says the mystery was revealed by the Spirit. Okay, so you have revelations and visions. Apostles is the way God uses to speak. In Acts 1, verse 2, it says that God has given commandments to his apostles, and those apostles wrote books of the Bible. It says in Acts 1, 2, until the day in which he was taken up, after that he, through the Holy Ghost, hath given commandments unto the apostles whom he had chosen. Apostles are chosen ones, given a message. And the epistles in your Bible written all by apostles. John, Peter, James, Jude, Paul, they're all apostles, okay? That's, we talked about last week, that's one reason why people think either Luke or Barnabas wrote Hebrews. They're also apostles. Some say Timothy did, right? So you have apostles being a way in which God speaks. 1 Corinthians 14:37, Paul says, those who are prophets who are spiritual, let them confirm that the things that I say unto you are the Lord. He said, the things that I write unto you are the commandments of the Lord. Let him acknowledge those things. So the way in which you can acknowledge who is speaking of the Lord is one manner which God speaks with another manner which God speaks. One guy has a dream, one guy has a revelation, the other guy an angel told him, and hey, they all match. So you have the gifts of prophecy in the early church, who there are prophets in the body of Christ. When Paul starts speaking, those prophets come to Paul and say, yep, God revealed to me the same thing Paul is saying here. So they acknowledged the things that Paul said was of the Lord. The prophets confirmed the prophets is what Paul says. And that's how we got our Bible. Okay? It wasn't by a committee. It wasn't by people just picking books. It was by inspiration of the Holy Spirit, preservation through his church. Okay? We have there the Son, which is another way in which God speaks through his Son. Hebrews 1:2, John 6:63. Jesus says, the words that I speak, they are life. You can't say that. Jesus said that. So the Son of God, the only way in which God has spoken as God manifest in the flesh is in Jesus Christ. Okay. course, the last way, and the way that's most precious to us, is through the direct inspiration of Scripture. 2 Timothy 3:16, all Scripture is given by inspiration of God. And it's Scripture that is in a book that is written down that is preserved for us. That's why it's so important, and we call ourselves Bible believers, and we believe in the preservation of God's Word, because without this book, the only way you know what God has said is if you've seen an angel, you've had a dream or a vision or a revelation, or hear him with an audible voice, oh, this describes charismatic Pentecostalism. They don't have a Bible, but they claim every other way in which God speaks. Okay. But we walk by faith in this dispensation, not by sight, which is what I told you earlier. And so in this dispensation of grace and faith, the only objective means in which we know that God has speaking to us today is through his inspired words. Okay, the revelation of Jesus Christ. Okay. Angels, Paul says, don't trust them. Okay, apostles, we have the apostle of the Gentiles. He's already given us Scripture. Paul says even another apostle. He said he himself, he says something different, don't believe it. All right. And they're about the mystery is what we know that God is doing today. So the only objective means is the Scripture. So anytime someone claims to be speaking of the Lord in any manner, first it must be a biblical manner. Okay, and then secondly, you confirm it with the Scripture, you say. And that's the only way you can know, the objective way of knowing what God is saying today. Now, Hebrews 1, verse 2, like I said before, he says God is speaking to us, and the us there is the audience of the Hebrews, not you. And he says he's spoken unto us by his Son. So the context here isn't by the Scriptures. He doesn't say by the Scriptures. He doesn't say he's spoken unto us by the Scriptures. He says he's spoken unto us by his Son. This is an audience who was around when Jesus was alive. This is an audience to whom these apostles were speaking. Those that knew Jesus Christ. Hebrews 2, 3, and 4 says that. Those who knew Christ told us of him and what he said and what he taught. It first began to be spoken by the Lord. Hebrews 2, verse 4. Okay. Or Hebrews 2, verse 3. And then it was confirmed unto us by them that heard him. So it was the Son that they were trusting. You see, at that time, maybe we should back up a step here. Realize that at Pentecost in Acts 2, they didn't open up their Bibles. Okay. All they had was Old Testament Scriptures, if they had any Scriptures whatsoever. They didn't have Matthew through John. They didn't have Paul's epistles. They didn't have Revelation or the Hebrew epistles. At Pentecost, all they had was Old Testament books. They were Jews, you see. So the only extra speaking of God that they had, apart from the law and the prophets given to Israel, was his Son, Jesus Christ. The words that he spoke, the teachings he taught, the Holy Ghost, who Jesus said will bring you into remembrance of the things that I said. You see? So when Hebrews 1, 2 says he has spoken in these last days, Peter says in Acts 2, these are the last days. In these last days he spoke unto them by his Son. This is the time period in which Hebrews is talking about, Hebrews was written. Okay? That's the people, the audience is talking to. You can't say that in Hebrews 1, 2. You can only confirm that in the historical sense that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And so, you know, we have the Bible, right? And Jesus Christ spoke to Paul and things like this. Yes, but it's historical. It's all in the past there, right? You have a book. That's how you know God speaks, is through a book. And so by his Son, and this is the key point we'll talk about next week once we cover the rest of chapter 1, is that this is the bombshell that Hebrews is trying to introduce to Israel, is that it's not just law and prophets anymore, guys. It's Jesus. It's the Messiah. It's the Christ. It's the Son of God who is greater than the angels. Hebrews 1, 2 says, his Son, whom he hath appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the world. Okay. Who being the brightness of his glory, the express image of his person, upholding the things by the word of his power. That's a lot of credential to give to Jesus of Nazareth. But it's all true because he is the Son of God, the Almighty Son of God. Okay? And so he's the only begotten of the Father, John 1:14. He's the only one that knows the Father, and the Father knows him. Is it Jesus Christ the Son? If you don't know the Son, you don't know the Father, Jesus says. So see, Hebrews is taking a step forward from Israel's Old Testament. It's a change. You can't reject Jesus any longer, Hebrews. You can't just say law and prophets. You can say law and the prophets and his Son, you say. And that right there will separate you from Judaism and Islam because they reject that because it's also through his Son. But it doesn't go as far enough as Paul. But it's the same thing John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Okay? You're not God's begotten Son. Jesus Christ is his only begotten Son. That's why it's important that verse say that, the only begotten Son. There are many sons of God. There's only one begotten Son of God. There's only one Son who's of the same nature of God. That's Jesus. Okay? You become sons of God by the Spirit that dwells in you when you put your faith in the gospel, Romans chapter 8. That is not a begotten Son of God who by nature from eternity is the Son of God. That's not what you are. Okay? That's different. Right? So, I put a few verses on the end there. We'll probably get to them next week, if not later, about how we know from the Bible that God did have a son. It's just very interesting to find in Proverbs 30, it talks about what is God's name or what is his son's name, you know. And Isaiah 7:14 talks about a child being born who is the Son of God, and so who is the Prince of Peace. Isaiah 7:14, these are important verses. Verses, by the way, that are changed in other Bible translations. So, again, the Bible translation issue matters. But the rest of the chapter, we'll get into detail about him being the Son, and now he's higher than the angels, and that's proof that he's the Son. And so we'll deal with that next week. Any questions, comments? A lot of stuff in that first verse in Hebrews. Important. All right. Lord, we thank you for sending your Son to minister to Israel and for giving inspired scripture through Israel so that we can know who you are. So we thank you for Israel. We thank you for your preserved word and your working in the world so that we can know your purpose and know what you the blessings you have for us. And we thank you again for your salvation through your Son, Jesus Christ, as he died on the cross for our sins. Amen. Thank you, folks.